So again, many thanks for the invitation. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. And no, in fact, it is. This school is very intense, also for me. It's 8:30, and I was not used to wake up so early. I had my coffee, so I am ready. Just to go back to what we were doing, what I am interested in is in the construction of a solution that blow up in the form of bubbling in infinite time for the what we call the critical heat equation. So it is the heat equation with a source, a power type source U to the P, and P is the critical Sobolev exponent. Here we are in a bounded domain and we ask for zero boundary condition at any time. So we were going through the proof, which consists in a first step. The first step of the proof is the construction of an approximate solution to start with. And yesterday, what we discussed was that, so we are looking for a bubbling blow up, and this is encoded in the fact that the approximate solution starts with a sum of bubbles centered at certain point Xi j, that when time t goes to plus infinity, converge to a point Qj of the domain, and with the scaling parameter that becomes smaller and smaller, they go to zero as t goes to infinity. And yesterday we discussed the fact that we can start with the bubble, but then a reasonable good correction, first correction, in order to take into consideration what happens far away from the blowing up point, we add the G, the regular part of the Green's function. So what matters close to the point of blow up is the bubble. And then but we have to take into account what happens far away. Okay, this was more or less what we were doing. In fact, we did something even, we went a little bit farther. We started with what I described, just described, and we started improving this approximation. And we realized that a way to improve it was to solve a linear problem, L0 of phi equals the one of the important part of the error, where this L0 of phi is an elliptic operator, and it is just the linearized operator around a single bubble. And we discussed that via a variation of parameter formula, we can construct a solution to this problem that improves the approximation. And we can construct this solution with a decay at infinity, provided that the error satisfies a certain orthogonality condition. Here, I am just considering the radial case. And here we have a K orthogonality condition, each one for each point. So what I want to discuss first today is what kind of information this relation gives us. So this relation is important, is necessary to get something that decays, but what does this mean? In our specific case, this orthogonality conditions, a read, you can really compute them explicitly, read as a system of k ordinary differential equations in the scaling parameter lambda j. They are, so there is lambda j dot, the derivative of lambda j with respect to t, and then there are power of lambda j and power of lambda I. So it is a system of nonlinear but ordinary differential equation that we want to solve. Now we expect that the rate at which each lambda j goes to zero is similar. It doesn't, so all, they all go to zero as t goes to plus infinity with the same speed. So if you put this information in the lambda j, and you can do it just writing a lambda j of t equal a certain lambda zero of t times a constant. So this writing tells you that all the lambda j in as function of t are a multiple of a fixed lambda zero t. So they have the same speed. If you do that, you obtain an expression which has a first part, which this is a constant. It depends on the number here, bj. Remember that the qj is the limit point. This doesn't depend on t. Another object, which is a constant here. Another object, which is a constant here. And here you see the time dependence. So what you do is, well, I put this equal to a constant. It must be a negative constant, a number, a negative number. It must be negative because lambda zero goes to zero. It is positive before, so lambda zero t is negative. It decreases. Okay, you do that. And you obtain that lambda zero sub t lambda zero satisfies this equation, this ordinary differential equation, and you get the speed in terms of time of lambda zero. So this is your choice of lambda zero. Take this choice of lambda zero and replace it here in this equation. What you get now is an algebraic nonlinear equation in the numbers bj, and you want to solve it for bj positive. If you find a solution with one bj negative, it's not useful because remember the bj, in fact I should have written here bj in R plus, the bj has to be positive because your scaling parameter is positive. And you can find those bj. You can find those bj, and it is here where we use the fact that you remember that famous matrix k times k is positive definite. The reason being that this equation star is nothing but solving the gradient in B of a certain function of the parameter B. This function is explicit. It has a very explicit expression. And this function has a critical point for in the quadrant where all the BJ are positive, because it is strictly convex. And you can prove that it is strictly convex thanks to the fact that your matrix is positive definite. It is strictly convex. It has a unique global minimizer. So you get in the set where you are allowed to be. So where all the bj are positive. Okay, so this is where we use the fact that the first moment in which we use the fact that this matrix is positive definite. If it is not positive definite, you cannot control this function. So you cannot find a critical point with all the entrances strictly positive. Very well. So we got after a little bit of work to an explicit function which will be our final approximation. And I will call it U star, and it is made by U lambda xi, the sum of the bubble, the correction with the regular part of the Green function, plus this term here that we have found solving a linear problem, where the parameter lambda j are the one we found before, plus something that we leave as a parameter, and the point xi j are in principle just points that as t goes to infinity, we want that they converge to this point qj. So this u star is a function of x and t, but its definition depends on the point xi t, and still on this mu j of t, which is, the scaling parameter are identified with what we saw before, plus something that you may take as smaller with respect to lambda zero t. So this extra parameter here, the expansion, is goes to zero faster than lambda zero as t goes to plus infinity. Okay, so once you have this, you can see the error that you created. The error looks like the following. If you focus your attention around one point of blow up, the xi j point of blow up, the error, which we call the S of U star, can be bounded by, don't forget about this, this is just a scaling that comes out from the equation. So the error can be bounded in the variable y, which is given by x minus xi j divided by lambda j. This is a variable that if you want allow you to make a zoom of what is going around the point xi j. So the error can be bounded, forget about this, by a certain negative power of t, okay, certain function that depends on t and goes to zero with a certain rate, divided by, multiplied by a function of the variable y that decays, that has this decay when y goes to infinity or y is large, it decays like 1 over y to a certain power bigger than 2. Okay, so it's the error can be bounded by a function of t to some minus number, divided by a function that in the y variable decays with a rate of size 2 plus a, and a is positive. Okay, just to have this in mind. So how do we find the true solution to the whole problem? Now I introduced here a t0, okay? I want to solve from t0 on. T0 will be, I will take t0 large, But this is irrelevant because you can always shift in time and start from t equals zero. The meaning of starting from t zero is to be already at a certain time where you are relatively close to the profile you are building, to the bubble, okay? And now I would like to explain how we find at least the scheme that we use to find a true solution. So we have the approximation and we want to find a true solution as the approximation plus something else, right? This phi tilde. And what I we use the terminology inner-outer gluing to express the fact that we look for this phi tilde in a very specific way. This phi tilde is decomposed as the sum of a psi, of a function psi, which is a function of x and t, plus a phi in. This phi in has a specific form. This phi in is given by the sum for each blow up point. We introduce a phi j tilde multiplied by a function eta, a cutoff. This cutoff means that you are zero if you are a distance 2r lambda j from psi j. So this cutoff leaves, is not zero, only when you are close to the point psi j. And this phi tilde j has a specific form, which is exactly the same form of the bubble. It is a scaling, there is a scaling, 1 over lambda j to power n minus 2 over 2 times phi j. Remember, the bubble itself, our main object, has the same form. It is a function now with this. It has exactly the same structure. So we look for a reminder, this phi tilde, as the sum of a function psi that will take into account what happens far away from the blow up point, plus sum of functions that have the same shape, the same structure as the bubble, but multiplied by a cutoff function. A cutoff function given at a certain point, capital R. Okay, so we put, and this is in a sense consistent with the approximate solution we built. Do you remember the approximate solution at the bubble? Then something that takes into account what happens far away from the bubble. And here it is the same philosophy. You write your extra term as something that takes into account what happens far away from the bubble, plus object that have the same shape as the bubble, multiplied by a cutoff. Okay, you can do that. It's why not? Okay, so this is a picture. This is the region where you have the cutoff. So this is the region where you have the phi j, and outside it is the region where you have the psi. Okay, you take this. You have the equation. You can write the equation in terms of phi tilde. Now phi tilde is the unknown. U star is given. Okay, you can do it. And the equation in Fitilde, of course, you can write it in this form. So there is a Fitilde sub t, then the linearized linear operator around your approximation, the old error, and the term which is nonlinear. So let me write the error as well as the potential that goes in front of phi tilde in this linear operator.
Sorry, Sara wrote a question that maybe will be useful if you saw it.
Yes, now. Sorry.
No, how does phi j depend on t, she asked.
Okay, I will go to this. Okay, so phi j, this phi j will be, as you mentioned perfectly, this is will be a function of this y for, and a function of t. And it will respect as a function of t the decay in time of the error. So let me see if it is written somewhere. Here it is written, I'm sure. Okay, so the function phi will be, so remember the error was something decaying in y, like 1 plus y to power 2 plus a. You have in the middle a Laplacian, so it's natural to lose to power of y. And you have a control in t, so it decays in t as t goes to plus infinity with a certain power of t, which is, say, small, the correct power that the error gives you. Okay, it depends on the error, and the error we computed it before. So it's a certain negative power of t. But as you said, yes, it is indeed a function of t. It's a function of y, and okay. So the error, we split the error. We use the same philosophy. We split the error as the error multiplied by the cutoffs and the other part. And we do the same with the potential in front of the linear term. So we have p to the u star to the p minus one. We add and subtract the cutoffs. Why do we do that? Because then we realize that the phi tilde will solve the equation if we can solve k plus one problems. K problems are given as an equation in the phi tilde j. And we define this equation in the phi tilde j just in the ball. Remember that the phi tilde j goes with a cutoff. So if you put the expression of phi tilde in the equation, you will get some operator, like for instance, dt of phi tilde multiplied by the cutoff. You factor out everything that comes with the cutoff itself, and what survives, you put it equal to zero. And what survives is an equation of this type, are in reality k equation in the phi tilde j of this type. Okay, so you have the part of the error inside the region of cutoff, you have a linear operator where you just see the bubble where you are doing the cutoff. And then you see something coming from the psi. And the psi, practically the psi solves everything else, everything that doesn't go with the in front with the cutoff. So the psi at the end of the day satisfies a certain heat equation with a potential here, but the potential is good, is not big. A nonlinear term, the part of the error outside, And you see how the phi tilde enters in the outer problem in this way, through this term here. But let me just say the following. You have an ansatz for the phi tilde, you do the computation, you put everything that goes with the cutoff eta r in front equal to zero, and you build up this this problem here that are problems in the unknown phi tilde j, and all the rest you put it as a something in an equation for psi. So the logic here is, assume I am able to find the psi solution of this with boundary condition, and the k and the k phi tilde j solution of this. Put them together, the phi tilde, the original phi tilde, gives you a solution of our equation. So, but let me write these two problems slightly better, in particular using the fact that the phi tilde j has the same shape as the same form, the same structure as the bubble. So that you have k problem, k inner problems that have this structure. You have dt, this comes from the scaling, equals the linear operator, the famous basic linear operator that we already discussed, plus the error, and plus a term that involves the psi, which is the unknown of the outer problem. On the other hand, the outer problem is a it equation plus a term involving the phi tilde j that are solution of the inner problem, and plus, say, this term is nonlinear, and this is the part of the error that you leave outside from the points. So here there are many unknowns and many, many problems. There is an unknown, this psi. There are j unknown, this phi j, but this phi j are a similar problem. They have the same the same structure. Then you still have to understand how to choose completely the lambda j, and finally the point psi j. Okay, looks terrible, but in reality, well, it simplifies, and at least we could solve. And the meaning of the inner problem, it is really that when you are close to one of the blow-up point, your problem, you zoom around your problem and you see this type of equation. And all the rest that, of course, you cannot forget goes in the so-called outer problem. But these two problems, of course, they cannot interfere that much, okay? So we will solve the outer problem just solving the it equation with a potential, okay? And we will solve the inner problem just inverting this operator here. But in order to do that, we have to be careful that the coupling, so the way the psi enters in the inner problem and the way the phi enters in the outer problem, we have to be careful that this coupling doesn't destroy the structure of the problem. So the way the inner problem enters, sorry, the psi, the outer problem enters in the inner problem is very simple. It is a certain scaling multiplied by a power of the bubble. And here, what you see really is the value of psi at xij. Remember, lambda goes to zero. Xij, say, it's the value of psi at the limit point Qj. So if you ask yourself, how does the outer problem enter in the inner problem, it enters in this way. And so you need to have control, in a sense, of a smallness somehow of this value here. Say psi evaluated at Qj, comma t. On the other hand, you also want that the inner phi j enter in the outer problem without destroying the structure. So we have to control somehow the phi j. In order to see how to control it in the phi j, you see, let us look at this thing here. In this expression here, sorry, there is, of course, this is eta j, sorry, okay. In this expression here, the phi j always come together with some derivative of the cutoff function. So in reality, if you want to control this expression here, it is enough to control the phi j or its gradient in a region where the derivative of the cutoff is not zero. Namely, in the region where the cutoff is between one and zero, okay? And this can be done, so you can control the phi in the region where the cutoff, when you have a derivative of the cutoff, if you control the decay of phi tilde and its derivative in the y variable. Because this is important only far away. So if I know that this is small far away, we are done. Okay, the general strategy to solve this problem goes as follows. We fix lambda, psi, and phi j in a certain good topology, and we solve the outer problem. This will be a function psi of x and t, which depends on the parameter that we fixed. Then we replace the solution of the inner problem, of the outer problem, in the inner problems, and we solve the inner problems. But remember, we have to solve in phi j for phi j decaying. If we can solve for phi j decaying, we are sure that the coupling doesn't destroy the structure of the outer problem. Now, in order to solve the inner problem in the phi j with the right topology, so with the phi j decaying fast or decaying to zero at infinity, we need to impose some condition on the parameter lambda and xi. And this will be the way we determine the lambda and xi. So let me just briefly mention what is the topology. So for the lambda, remember the lambda j f a main term, and we ask that the what comes next goes to zero faster than lambda zero. And also for the points, we just ask that the points converge to Qj at a certain rate, negative power of t. This is what we ask, but then a posteriori, we will have to check that what we found lives in this topology. And concerning the topology of phi j, so let me call it phi, as Azara asked, so the error decays like 1 over y to power 2 plus a, so we need a decay for the inner function in such a way that it doesn't destroy the structure of the outer problem. And the natural decay that one could expect is this one, right? Because when you are far away, this decays. It's not such a big decay, but this is enough for the method to work. In reality, we are not that lucky to get this bound. We need a bigger topology. And the bigger topology, let me write this in here and let me comment the difference. So the real topology that we will use for lambda will be, say, a certain decay in time, which is decided by the error. This is fixed. And then concerning the decay in a space, remember that the y here goes up to a big ball of size 2r. We cannot have this bound. We have the following bound. It is r to power n plus 1 minus a divided by 1 plus y to power n plus 1 minus a. And let me comment on what is the difference between this and this. If you see, if you are right on the boundary, or you are at a distance far away, say you are at a distance y of order capital R, you put here capital R, you put here capital R, and these two objects have the same size. They are both far away of size 1 over capital R to power A. So far away, these two functions, far away meaning far away in the region we are considering, these two functions looks very similar, okay? Where they do not look similar is inside, because assume now that y is bounded. Now y is zero, for instance. This y is a distance one from the origin. Here you have a bounded object, bounded by one, but here you have something that is big. This capital R is a big number. So in another word, we have decay, but we lose a certain power of capital R. Okay, but it's okay. So the basic theory to solve the outer problem is just, so this potential here is small. We took out the big part of the potential, and we use barrier to prove estimate for the outer problem. And we could solve, say, I don't want to go into the detail, for lambda, psi, phi, in the right topology, we could solve in psi the outer problem. So let me mention what are the key characteristic for the linear equation that enters in the inner problem, where we lose so many powers of capital R. Well, the basic object for the linear theory in the inner problems is this operator here. Okay. Now we recognize this operator here. This is the linearized equation operator around the bubble that we already discussed. It has several elements in the kernel. So it is expected to solve this problem here that the right-hand side satisfies certain orthogonality condition. Because if you have an element of the kernel of this elliptic operator, of course, zeta j doesn't depend on t, so it is also in the kernel with dt of phi j. But there is a bad guy, which is capital zeta, because the this elliptic operator L0 has a negative or a positive eigenvalues, which and corresponding eigenfunction is very good decay. What I want to say is that given the existence of this eigenvalue, if you have a solution of this equation, you multiply it against this eigenfunction, so you have, and then you integrate, the solution have a component along this eigenfunction. Let me call it ET, so the component of the solution against this zeta is called E. You take this E, you take the equation, and you get that E satisfies a certain ODE. And this is the solution of the ODE. And from the solution, we see that this E of T, which represents the projection of phi along zeta, grows exponentially fast at infinity. And you don't want that. You want to avoid that. So it is reasonable to avoid this, to ask somehow to avoid this, this direction. You don't want to grow exponentially. And you can do it by asking a certain initial condition. And this is the reason of the codimension one manifold stability of this phenomena with respect to the initial condition. So what I want to say is that in order to avoid this initial, this growth, this direction which you grow, you solve the inner problem with a certain initial condition. So you impose that the initial condition is a multiple of this function capital zeta, and in this way, you avoid the exponential growth of phi. Okay, so here we should add, so plus the initial condition that at time t zero, you want to be a certain multiple of zeta of y. This initial condition implies that you don't grow, okay? You avoid the instability direction that you want to avoid. Okay, so the inner problem, how does it look like? So you have lambda square phi t equal the linear operator, then you have an error. Now, at first, a very simple thing is you want to get rid of this lambda square, and you can do it with a very simple change of variable. So you change the variable t with the variable tau in time to get rid of this lambda square. So your linear problem, your inner linear problem, can be written as d tau of phi j equal the operator L0 plus an error term with a certain initial condition that you ask to avoid the bad growth direction. Now, we can solve, in fact, that this is what I want to do next, maybe next time, because I really ran out of time. I want to describe to you how we construct this solution. But remember, the solution we have to construct, they work for our purpose only if we are able to prove that they decay in Y. Some, maybe we lose size, but we cannot lose decay, because if we don't guarantee decay, this phi will enter in the outer problem and everything just get destroyed. So the decomposition of phi tilde in the inner and outer problem doesn't work anymore. In order to get decay, I will prove next time that what you need is that your H satisfy again certain orthogonality condition, which are this one, okay? They are ODEs. I'm not going to discuss that much, except for the fact that these ODEs will give you exactly the size of mu j. Remember, the lambda j have a main part, lambda zero, plus a reminder. You get the reminder. But more important even than this is the type of equation you get for the location of the point. Let me focus on this equation, which is not written well, but so the meaning of this equation is the following. You have xi t, and xi t is a vector equal a certain vector of size capital O of one times this t to minus n minus two divided by n minus four. And the key point here is that this power here, n minus two divided by n minus four, is bigger than one. Being bigger than one, it means that you can integrate, you can solve this differential equation integrating from t to infinity. You can integrate from t to infinity s to power minus n minus two divided by n minus four, which is what you do, because you are lucky, and n minus two divided by n minus four is bigger than one. In this way, you don't need to say, well, the limit point qj needs to satisfy some extra condition, like being critical point of something, which is what happens in analogous problem, just elliptic problems. So, okay, this is, so what I would like to do next time to really solve the linear problem, the linear inner problem. So what I will do will be just to focus on this proposition. If you have a right hand side h which has a certain decay, and satisfies certain orthogonality condition, I will solve the linear inner problem, and I will find a solution that has this kind of bound. I think I will stop here for today. Thank you very much.